So the topic of this panel, which will last for 30 minutes before we start the debate and hopefully set up most of the big topics that will then be dissected in the debate, the topic is the Great Decoupling, the U.S.-China race for tech supremacy. And given that I think it's true to say the engagement between China and the U.S. over the last 40 years has been a huge part of the global story over those four decades, if we are really now on the cusp of an era of decoupling, then that says a lot about how the story of the world might change in coming decades. So pretty important topic to discuss and a wonderful panel to discuss it. Let me start with Samm Sacks. Samm is cybersecurity policy fellow at New America. She's worked on technology policy issues for over a decade, and now she's writing a book about data and the U.S.-China competition. This year alone, I think, she has testified to Congress three times, so that's got to be going on for a record. Next to me here is Yasheng Huang, will be known to any China scholar in the room. Yasheng is the Epoch Foundation Professor of International Management at the MIT School of Management. I've personally been reading his stuff for years. He's the author of 11 books, but I think the one I'll mention is a seminal work for me, Capitalism with Chinese Characteristics. It obviously is one of the key works of the whole reform and opening era. And Yasheng, I think we should say a special thanks to, he just flew down from Boston straight after this panel. He's into his Uber and then back to the airport to go back to Boston. So really a big thanks there. Duncan Clark, again, will be known to, I imagine, all of you in the room. He's a luminary expert on the internet and China entrepreneurship. He's chairman of BDA China, consultancy that he founded in 1994, long before it was fashionable to do so, I think. And he's author of Alibaba, The House That Jack Ma Built, which, as you know, is a runaway bestseller. Duncan's also on the board of trustees here at the Asia Society. So, Samm, first of all, coming to you, we've had this engagement period. We're now supposedly on the cusp of this decoupling era. Let's kick the tires a little, please, on this. What does decoupling really mean, and how real is it between the US and China right now?
I think that decoupling is becoming a self-fulfilling prophecy. But let's just back up and talk about how we got to this moment. About a year or so ago, the U.S. began, I'd say, with overhauling CFIUS, the committee that evaluates foreign investment to find out if it's a national security threat. We also have overhaul of the export control regime. Chinese scientists, students, and researchers who are in the STEM fields are being accused of spying. That's just in Washington. In Beijing, I think, this is really a perfect storm because you have an administration around Xi Jinping who is doubling down on reducing reliance on foreign suppliers and core technologies. And I think that you add on to all of this the U.S. effort to essentially kill Huawei around the world. We're at this moment. I think we are now just beginning to see the effects of this. I'm hearing from colleagues in Silicon Valley that VCs are beginning to reject Chinese investment, sometimes even asking for passports. We're starting to see more restrictions in terms of export control licenses. The latest salvo last week was the sanctioning of 28 Chinese companies and government agencies related to surveillance technology in Xinjiang. But I think this is a self-fulfilling prophecy in that it began at a rhetorical policy level, and we are starting to really feel the effects of this in the ways that I just mentioned.
Thank you. Duncan, when you look at decoupling, and you're very well informed about the tech world, do you see many sort of concrete expressions of it in terms of tech?
Well, I think manufacturing, we've already seen expressions from companies, U.S. companies, looking to shift production lines away. And some said, well, this will take 10 years to fully take into effect. But don't forget, the product cycle is moving very rapidly. As I was just talking to an executive last night who said, you know, for new products already, we will say that's going to be in Vietnam or in Malaysia. The irony of this, by the way, is it's Chinese probably running those factories in Malaysia and Vietnam because Chinese and Taiwanese basically control a lot of the manufacturing know-how globally now, effectively. But mainland China itself as a base for production, we're already seeing, you know, that's going to have an interesting impact that you will follow, I'm sure, on the Chinese economy and labor markets. But that's a visible sign that we see now. The invisible thing is things that we would expect with, you know, Christmas coming and so on is prices and some of the hesitancy of Trump to sort of really go ahead with this next round of tariffs is expressed on things like the, you know, iPhones if they were suddenly subject to this. And I want to create quote the great American philosopher Dave Chappelle, actually riffs on this in his Netflix special. You know, it's great that these Chinese jobs are coming back, but, you know, none of us actually want to do these things, make these things ourselves. Who wants to pay $9,000 for an iPhone? And he says, you know, I want to wear the Nike shoes. I don't want to make them. You know, so there is this sense of sticker shock is coming for the creeping. We're already seeing it in GDP levels. Maybe 0.8%, 1% of global GDP might be affected by all this stuff. But when it starts coming to the consumer level, this is important because this is, you know, who has the greatest staying power? Is it the U.S. or China on this battle to really decouple? Because decouple is almost dismembering. I mean, it's not an easy process. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, companies are looking at it. Consumers haven't yet really fully felt the impact.
So do you feel that there is actually U.S. manufacturing capacity moving back to the U.S. from China?
Well, you know,
or is it sort of, you're talking if it did?
It's Southeast Asia that's the greatest initial benefit. I mean, Vietnam, right. You know, try to get a hotel right now in, right. In Ho Chi Minh City or in Hanoi. I mean, you can visibly feel that influx. By the way, there's dangers to that as well for a smaller country like Vietnam to absorb that. But no, we already see people actively talking about that. Moving back to the U.S., I mean, you only have to look at the Wisconsin, you know, fiasco for, you know, with Trump and Foxconn and so on, where there simply isn't the know-how, the capability, and they were flying in, you know, Taiwanese to Wisconsin. And so right. I don't think it's a U.S. story, and why would you? I mean, that's a whole different topic. But no, Southeast Asia definitely is a beneficiary. India has been held up by some. If you talk to, you know, Chambers at Cisco, he's talking up India. I don't really see that yet, but it depends how long this is going to go on. Then anything is possible.
Yes, I mean, I think I heard somewhere the other day that the main impact of Trump's MAGA policy would be to make Vietnam great again.
Yes, exactly.
Yasheng, just moving to you then. So if we think about, you know, we're perhaps on the cusp or maybe the decoupling has already started. If this was to happen, what would be the potential impacts on the two economies?
Yeah, I think to think about the impact and the implications, we have to start with recognizing the following two facts, which is that one, technology and R&D are both competitive activities as well as collaborative activities. So the decoupling would negatively affect the not just the US and China, but global pace of technology and scientific development, simply because these two countries are now collaborating with each other in science and technology. So to take not a very obvious example, in 5G, right? So the idea is that Huawei, we should kind of knock down on Huawei, so we develop our own 5G. The company that is in the best position to develop 5G is Qualcomm. And the Trump administration now is restricting the supply of key components from Qualcomm to Huawei. And Qualcomm's exposure to China is something like close to 60% of its revenue. Essentially, by decoupling, you're hurting Qualcomm. You're destroying its revenue model. If you look at other high-tech companies in the United States, their China exposure, you know, Microsoft and Apple, all these companies, is something like 23%, right? So companies need the operating income to finance, to fund R&D. And the other thing about the entity list, the decoupling, is incredibly harmful to the U.S. And it works in the following way. So the company that is on the entity list, the fact it is on the entity list doesn't mean that the U.S. company cannot supply to the company. It can supply upon approval. But that's the only thing you can do. You cannot have any conversations, cannot have any exchange of resources outside of this very well-defined, narrow supply contract. So let's think about Qualcomm. So 5G is both a technology and a standard. To ban Qualcomm from talking to Huawei, essentially, you are not allowing Qualcomm to participate in discussions on the standard on 5G. Right? So the detrimental effect, sometimes we talk about the detrimental effect on China. There's a lot of that as well. But we underappreciate how the decoupling is going to hurt the United States. And talking about the VC investments in the from China, if you look at the VC investments in the United States, basically the distribution is bimodal. A lot of money in life science, a lot of money in basically software. A lot of the things in between are not attracting VC money. Chinese are investing in all these things, in renewable energy, in material, in materials, and in a host of other things other than life science and software. So not allowing Chinese companies to come in to make those investments is actually hurting U.S. entrepreneurs who desperately need the money to develop renewable product. And at MIT, we know quite a few cases like that. So we have to recognize the harmful effect of this policy. I'm not saying that that we shouldn't challenge China, but I believe there are better ways to do it.
Just staying with you for 1 minute, because I've also been struck by the level of dependence of the U.S. semiconductor manufacturers on the China market. I think the number I read was 67% of Qualcomm's annual sales are in China. So how does this play out for them? I mean, surely, if the U.S. wants to decouple from China, China's going to decouple right back.
Well,
what does that mean for the semiconductor
guys? I mean, trade war, we know the basic logic of trade war is both sides get hurt, right? Mm. That we know. And the issue is who is going to to get hurt more. I think in a very static sense, China gets hurt more simply because Chinese economy is slowing down. And you feel the pain more when your economy is slowing down when you have a trade war. Whereas the U.S., the economic, although now they are dark clouds on the horizon. When the U.S. economy is in the up trajectory, you don't feel the pain of the trade war as much. But the economic effect is identical, whether or not you lose the things you already have, which is China, or you don't gain the things you could have gained, which is in the case of the United States. Economically, these are two identical things. So it's going to hurt China. There's no question about it. But I think we need to also recognize it's hurting the U.S. too.
Right. Samm, how do you see that? I mean, how do you see it playing out? Is it just, are they just going to slug each other to a standstill or what?
So much of the conversation is about looking at the cost in relative terms, right? The U.S. will suffer this, China will suffer this. I think we need to zoom out even further, because if you think about technology and data in particular, not really mapping onto political borders the way it did during the Cold War, I think that the costs are going to be on a global level, on a human level, right? You know, thinking about something like artificial intelligence, the idea that innovation just flows one way across the Pacific is wrong now. This is innovation flowing two directions. So when you cut off, when you separate like that, what you're doing is you're delaying things like, you know, the use of genetic data. China has an enormous amount of data that is needed for things like predictive medicine and disease diagnosis. But, you know, U.S. R&D is working, has amazing algorithms that can be applied to that data. And that's where you get those advantages in terms of moving forward with curing cancer. So that's a human cost. When we talk about, I think both sides are grappling with the real, with ethical and safety issues around how these technologies are going to disrupt society. And I worry that there is even a graver cost if we think about the threats that future generations will have as machine and human, and we start to question what does human even mean as computers are woven more seamlessly through our lives. There is even more danger, I would argue, to cutting off that level of interconnection.
And yet, I think, you know, there's also a very legitimate concern that many people have that their data might be harvested by a Chinese company, used by the Chinese deep state for whatever reason. So how do you balance those two things? I mean, you're writing a book about it.
Yeah.
Are we actually going to on the brink of another big change in the world, which is a sort of a balkanization of everybody's data? We have a kind of China and its satellites and the rest of the world.
So that the case of the Grindr case, where Grindr was acquired by a Chinese gaming company, and CFIUS earlier this year said, wait a second, that needs to divest because the data that Grindr has could maybe be triangulated with, say, assuming that the Chinese government has the millions of records from the OPM hack, national security sensitive data. What happens if that data is triangulated? That case to me was a real milestone, and I think we're going to begin to see more of that, where the U.S. government is increasingly looking at global transaction from the lens of who will have access to U.S. citizen data and do what with it. And it's not just CFIUS. Last May, the Trump administration signed an executive order which gives the Commerce Department very broad authority to block any deal in the digital economy. What is the digital economy? By a foreign adversary. I think in the next couple days, they're actually going to define China as a foreign adversary as part of the interim rules for that. So that could give them the authority to block data flows. I mean, I think that the U.S. may be moving away from a traditional free flow of data regime, and data is going to become a new focal point in this geopolitical competition.
So it does sound like you think there's going to be a fundamental split in the world between China and its data and the West?
Well, let's see how effective they are at doing that, right?
Right.
I mean, this, again, gets at this point of, can you actually map data onto political borders like that? Let's see if you can actually achieve that.
Right, okay. Duncan, you obviously wrote the book about Alibaba. Alibaba is a huge company, Tencent. There are big Chinese tech companies going all over the world. How will it affect, if this starts to happen, how will it affect them? You know, should we all start selling Alibaba shares? You know, they have a very large international operations.
They do, but they're still primarily a China-focused business. So their international operations are, for example, you know, just in Paris for Fashion Week, it's showcasing brands that Alibaba was involved with to sell into China. So, it's still the sell-to-China model, essentially. And it's still fundamentally, for them and for Tencent, really a domestic model. I mean, Tencent has some gaming operations globally. An interesting company we haven't mentioned yet is TikTok or ByteDance or Toutiao, depending how you want to refer to it. That company emerged without backing from Alibaba and Tencent, and you may know it from Musical.ly. Your kids know it if you don't know it. and this is also, you know, people are questioning the use of data. But an interesting point, I was just chatting with a friend last night, that the advertising that this platform had on Google and Facebook was number one ad buyer on both Facebook and Google was this Chinese company promoting this, you know, viral video, short video stuff. That probably won't be able to happen again, in a sense, right now. It's going to be hard to see a Chinese company that, through acquisition or advertising, would suddenly have a major global position. They're very big in the U.S. They're big in India, you know, not in traditionally close countries to China. So I think we're going to see, certainly Southeast Asia is almost, a backyard for China. Mm. We're seeing a massive venture capital investment. Some of it diverted from going to the U.S., going into Southeast Asia, even India. Chinese money heading there. China has an excess of capital to invest, and it has the nous, you know, it has this entrepreneur, the stuff I wrote about with Jack Ma. I mean, there are, you know, amazing entrepreneurs in China. And we should say one thing, on a consumer technology basis, The U.S. is lagging behind in a number of areas, I would say. For example, tonight it's raining. In China, it wouldn't be a problem. We could, you know, we could have umbrellas for everybody here in 5 minutes, you know, with aspirin if you were, didn't like what I was saying. You know, I mean, the level...
How do you get the umbrellas here in 5 minutes?
Well, you go on Meituan or you go on Ulema or, you know... I mean, it's the instant gratification of being a consumer in China, I mean, is pulling ahead of the U.S., not to mention the network level. I mean, at the center of Stanford, it's still trying to get a 3G network. I mean, forget 5G. The U.S. would be, you know... I see these things like GPRS. I'm like, oh my God, that takes me back 10 years. You know, U.S. has a major problem with its own infrastructure investment, I believe. And if you look at the OECD tables, the U.S. is falling very rapidly behind. I think some 60, 70 million people only have one choice of internet provider. And another reason why Trump has delayed some of the hit on Huawei, for example, the sole supplier to some rural areas of rural access equipment. Mm. So. To Yasheng's point, to both your point, the costs of this are pretty big for the U.S. and also the U.S. relationship with other countries. We've seen in Europe the attempt to block Huawei from selling into, you know, traditional allies like the U.K. and Germany, and the pushback that's come.
So, in a way, then, could the U.S. begin to use this as a bit of a Sputnik moment, you know, as a kind of galvanizing time of, my goodness, China is kind of going to eat our lunch? They're ahead of us in so many different tech areas. We need to really get moving. Do you think that's a possibility?
I think it is in China. It's a Sputnik moment. but you know, what's Sputnik here? No. I mean, people know what Sputnik is, and there's a paranoia associated with Sputnik, which, you know, we see here. Frankly, the Reds under your bed. This is an old expression of you know, the anti-Chinese sentiment going back hundreds of years, or the Reds under your bed. The Reds may be under your bed, but the bed is made in China, so you have a choice. Do you want to sleep on the floor? You know, I should say at one point, we do, and Robert Gates talked about, you know, the need for a small yard and a high fence, and I think you've quoted him. I think that's a great... Of course, we have to protect core IP. We have to reinforce stuff, but it's having a major impact. I was just at Stanford back where I used to run this China 2.0 program, which I should probably call China negative 0.6 now. I mean... And it was all about security and intelligence. But the concern is the impact on research and the basically racism that is now attached to.
Right.
And the second-order impact. So second-order impact on what you mentioned with, you know, cancer research or Alzheimer's. I mean, this is, you know, this is really against the U.S. self-interest and also U.S. relationship with other countries. I mean, and developing markets is where all the growth is. You know,
right.
So if the U.S. isn't even manufacturing this stuff to sell there... Well, they're basically promoting Ericsson, or I mean, it's a very strange arrangement. I understand the neurosis, the neuralgia about it, but this is the wrong way to go
this
about it.
This concept of small yard, high fence, you know, I've tried to bring it a little bit back into
yes.
the narrative, and I testified
let's make small,
about it.
Small fence.
So then the question is, okay, so what goes in the yard, right?
Yes.
The idea is let's be selective about what we want to protect,
yes.
but aggressive in protecting it. So what does that actually look like, right? And I think that there are a lot of tools that are out there under discussion. I mean, one is the overhaul of the export control regime. There are loopholes, important areas that need to be closed. But then the question is, how do you export control something like AI, which it's very easy for code to flow across borders? And the whole issue that's come up around the NBA, which is saying that, you know, tech companies have dealt with a lot of these issues as well. So how do you sort of put guardrails around it? And I think that there are tools out there to discuss, whether it's international standards that talk about the ways that you engage in joint research. You know, it's not just, does your partner in China have a relationship with the party? Okay. Everyone has a relationship with the party. There are more specific questions that you can ask to get at this small yard high fence, and I think it's important to have that conversation.
I guess that's a sort of an ideal. At one point in the future, we might get to a situation where the rules and regulations are clear, we know what's, you know, what's in field, and we know what's, you know, out of boundary, and so people can then act accordingly. But I think there are some areas where it becomes very tricky, and Yasheng, I'd like to ask you about this, because I know you used to work in MIT Sloan's partnership programs.
Yeah.
And what's your sense at the moment about this very uncomfortable feelings of decoupling in the education space in the U.S. between China and the U.S.?
Well, so China and U.S. have exactly the opposite preferences. China restricts social science. Especially importing social science knowledge into the country. China encourages importing of natural science knowledge, and U.S. has exactly the opposite preferences, right? So we want to export human rights, democracy, freedom of speech to China, but now the Trump administration is very concerned about scientific and technological knowledge flow. So if you look at just broad statistics, so the latest statistic, 2018, there are about 5,000 Chinese nationals who received PhDs in science and engineering fields. The second largest country is India, but it's not even close, right? This is 2,000. So think about the implications of cutting down the number of the Chinese. You can't get India to replace the Chinese PhD students if you restrict them. There's no way, right? So you look around the labs at MIT, Harvard, Stanford, you know, who is working in the labs, postdocs, PhD students. Many of them are Chinese. Many of them are Indian. And science is actually a labor-intensive activity. You need a lot of people doing science. And not only you need professors, you need research assistants, you need research associates, you need research scientists, you need technicians. It's a very, very complicated, labor-intensive, high human touch enterprise, right? You disrupt this enterprise, you disrupt this supply chain. The end result is a slowing down of the scientific progress and reducing the quality of the science and technology in the United States. And how do you compete with China with a lower level of technology and science, right? So I do want to say a little bit about this Sputnik moment. I agree with Duncan that it is galvanizing the Chinese, but I don't think Chinese can succeed with their system. If you look at where the Chinese have made the most progress in science and technology, they are making the most progress in areas where they are collaborative with foreign institutions, with Japan, with Europe, with the United States. The Chinese own system is actually not very good in terms of coming up with breakthrough ideas and innovation. Commercial success is for sure. That's because of the consumer base and all of that. But it is not galvanizing the United States. If you watch yesterday's the debate among the Democratic presidential contenders, the only person who sort of talked about technology is a Chinese guy, right? Andrew, right? And, you know, at least he sort of said AI, you know, robotics. Other people don't even mention it. And it's just amazing, right? So the U.S. is failing. The Democrats and the Republicans are bashing China. Yeah, I can understand some of that, but you want to bash China productively, right? You want to galvanize the country. If you look at the federal spending on research, in real terms, it has decreased. So rather than increase, this is not a Sputnik moment. So I worry about sort of the perception that the U.S. is trying to stop China. But it doesn't really care about the science and technology in its own country because it doesn't have the action to match the rhetoric.
Right. So maybe we shouldn't call it a Sputnik moment. Maybe it's a boomerang moment. You know, you take an action and it does the opposite. But okay, I haven't warned the panel. I'm going to ask this question, so it's a little bit unfair, totally unfair. But anyway, I'm going to do it. I just thinking about this because we've had some fascinating perspectives, but I'd really like to crystallize how serious we think this decoupling is. So I'd like you to put yourself 5 years from now. Bear in mind that this year, bilateral trade between the US and China was about 800 billion US dollars. There's been about 600 billion US dollars of US investment into China in foreign direct investment in the last 15 years. VC money has been flowing back and forth into both countries. And the last category I'd like to mention is just what you said about federal spending on science and innovation in the US. And I'd like you to put yourselves 5 years from now and tell me what type of decoupling do you think we will be living with that time? Will there be a complete shutdown in terms of Chinese money coming into the US to invest in startups? Will there be a sort of you know, a kind of a winter for Chinese students coming to the U.S. to study at U.S. universities? Will it hit foreign direct investment of U.S. companies into China? Will it hit trade? Duncan, you're quick at thinking on your feet. How about you, please?
Well, that's frankly why we don't have to look at it just as a U.S.-China thing. I mean, I'm you know, spending more time in Japan. I spend more time in looking at Africa and so on. I think if that's the case, if the nightmare scenario is of the U.S.-China sort of withering, then, you know, stuff will go elsewhere. I mean, Chinese capital will go elsewhere. Chinese talent will go elsewhere. China is having a problem right now of losing talent as it is, partly for the reasons you mentioned about the system not working for Chinese who want to get ahead. But, you know, that's a long time out, 5 years from now. So we could actually see some strange second-order impacts involving other countries and other trends. The U.S.-China thing, I just don't know if the U.S. consumers are going to, you know, vote for this continuous, you know, decoupling if it is the $9,000 iPhone or the $3,000, you know, Nike. I mean, which is linked to this. I mean, I think there is this pain element. Who can endure the most pain? The other big question is the Chinese economy. What would be the impact of a serious slowing of the Chinese economy on the Chinese, you know, political space, right, given with Hong Kong? So there's too many unknowns. But I don't see it, frankly. I mean, I think it's going to get worse before it gets better. But I just don't see the intelligence and the militarization of this debate. You know, the problem is they never show us the proof. You know, it's like if it is that we have to know, you know, the level of hacking. Or remember this fake Bloomberg story about chips that were put on every Chinese chip. I mean, there's just a lot of rhetoric and
Bloomberg has yet to deny.
Indeed, it's been a year, more than a year, and so I think this rhetoric, which will probably, of course, increase in the U.S. presidential election, even if they don't talk about technology. but at some point, one would hope, depending on who's elected, you know, a year from then, we'll start to get to them. You know, it's going to be a rough ride for the next, you know, 12 months. Right. And then I would hope we're not going to be that nightmare in 5 years.
Samm, 5 years from now, what does it look like?
So Duncan mentioned that there are other important places to look at. Mm-hmm. And I think we're going to start to see, you know, assume that we continue to go down the path with Huawei, for example, and Huawei doesn't get an Android license. So let's look at what it's going to look like in places like India or Latin America, where you're going to have Huawei phones coming preloaded with a bunch of Chinese apps. They're not going to have Uber and Google and YouTube. They're going to have the Chinese internet platform apps. And you're still going to have phones with Western apps, but you're going to have this sort of that, you know, we hear a lot about this bifurcation. I think that's too simplistic. You're going to have more sort of proxy competitions like that. I also think we are going to probably start to see what I'm calling this data spheres of influence, where certain countries are going to increasingly put up blocks to trade data with others. So maybe you could have a Japan, US, EU sort of free flow data transfer mechanism, and there's going to be effort to block data flows as a geostrategic tool. And for tech companies that are caught in the middle of all this, the costs and the inefficiencies just go up, right? So you're designing multiple products that are incompatible and standards are incompatible, and it's just messy and inefficient if we keep going down this path.
Right, so data balkanization and a sense there, I think, of, you know, if the U.S. does this decoupling, they might self-isolate,
you know? You know, I think the one that's going to, I think China actually is going to become much more self-isolated. I think we're going to start to see, it's not going to kill Huawei per Rubio's comment, if CFIUS decides to unwind the TikTok acquisition of Musical.ly. That's just going to make these companies more inward-focused Chinese companies, and I think China, the size of the market and the growth is going to maybe sustain them. It's going to be harder for these companies to compete. It's already very hard to compete outside of China, and we're going to see a more closed system for them.
Yasheng, five years?
So I don't know what's going to happen in 5 years. I would say it depends. It depends on politics. Politics, not just, you know, whether or not we have a new president next year. That would be good regardless. And but it depends on ideas. It's very important to remember that the level of economic interactions, the FDI numbers you quoted, the trade and all of that, they're actually based on some consensus about politics on both sides. In the United States, it was based on engagement, right? So do more of this stuff, then the politics there is going to change. So that's based on the political idea, not just on the economic idea. In China, it was also based on a convergence idea, which is that previous Chinese leaders wanted the country to move toward a more market economy, maybe not a democracy, but a little bit in that direction, right? So what I worry about is that both of these two types of consensus have completely collapsed, both within U.S. as well as within China. In the U.S., it's really civilizational conflict and all of that. China's increasing nationalism and actually denying the fact that China gained so much from globalization. Mm-hmm. I mean, China is the most beneficiary of globalization. To deny that, it's just unbelievable, right? So it's just flying against the data. So it's going to depend on whether or not those ideas are going to come back. I don't really have a good scenario how those ideas are going to come
right.
back.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. I'm afraid that's all we have time for. We could have spent a lot longer talking about this topic, but please show your warm appreciation for our excellent panelists.